Good evening, ladies and gents. How's everyone tonight? Can y'all hear me okay? Excellent. Okay. My name is Mark Razzi, as you probably know. I'm from the Public Services Office. Just wanted to thank you guys all for coming out tonight. And for those of you joining us on the web tonight, thanks for coming. NASA's next mission to Mars, the Mars Science Laboratory, now named Curiosity, will be landing with an extremely unique landing system, a sky crane invented by the mission team specifically to land a large rover in scientifically exciting locations on Mars, quite a change from the airbags used on Spirit and Opportunity. Tonight's talk will look at the fascinating history and evolution of how the sky crane landing architecture evolved from simple landing legs used on JPL's Surveyor landers of the 1960s to the current design, and will describe how the mission team spent years evaluating the landing techniques used on missions from Viking, Lunokhod, Pathfinder, and Apollo to distill out the features and performance from each that helped meet the demanding requirements of the Mars Science Laboratory mission. Tonight's guest received his bachelor's degree in aerospace engineering from Syracuse University in 1989 and his master's degree in aerospace engineering from the University of Texas at Austin in 1991. He has been working at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory for the last 15 years developing innovative landing systems for a variety of planetary landers. He co-invented the Mars Pathfinder MER entry, descent, and landing system architecture and was the lead engineer for the airbag subsystem in the Mars Pathfinder mission, for which he was later awarded a NASA Exceptional Achievement Medal. In addition, he was the recipient of the AIAA Engineer of the Year Award in 1998 for his role in the Pathfinder mission. He has led the mechanical development of the Deep Space 2 Mars Microprobe mission, the Mars Sample Return mission's sample transfer chain system, and has led the development and test of several prototype advanced landing systems for the Mars Science Laboratory project. He also served as the Deputy Mechanical Systems Architect for the Mars Exploration Rover mission. He is currently the Mechanical Systems Engineer responsible for the development of the Mars Science Laboratory's entry, descent, and landing hardware elements. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming tonight's guest, Mr. Tom Rivellini.
On. Okay. Hi, everybody. I'm Tom Rivellini. Put my water down here somewhere. And so I want to have some fun tonight because I've been having a lot of fun in this project for like the last 5-10 years. And I kind of want to give you a sense of the things that we've done over time, why we did them, how we did them. And if you're an engineer, all the stuff that we did was a lot of fun. So I want to kind of get that message across to you guys. And then at the end, we can ask you guys can ask questions, and we can talk about some of the details. So originally, I had kind of put this little picture up because I thought it was funny, and I thought it would kind of show it. But the more I thought about it, the more apropos it really is to this discussion tonight, because what we're talking about tonight really is a Darwinian evolution of technology, how we went from simple technologies in the 60s all the way to much more advanced technologies today, and all the different paths that started evolving and then got cut off, and then branches came off of that and got cut off and eventually worked their way up into what we have today. And so I'll start by giving a little bit of background about Mars and landing on Mars to give you some sense of the challenge of actually landing on Mars, and then we'll get into a much more focused discussion on what we call the touchdown system, which is the part that actually finishes the job and gets the payload that you want on the surface of Mars safely on the ground. So the Mars challenge, what's so interesting and difficult about Mars? It's a very big planet, very diverse, very rugged landscape, mountains and rocks all over the place. 3/8 of Earth's gravity, so things don't weigh as much. It doesn't really affect us too much in the touchdown system, but it affects us as we're coming into Mars because it's got a lot of gravity and it really sucks you in hard, and then you have to deal with a lot of entry velocities. The atmosphere, Mars is an interesting planet. It has 1/100th of Earth's atmosphere, so it's kind of like going up to 90,000 feet here on Earth. There's just enough atmosphere that you got to deal with it. If you want to land on the surface, you got to deal with it because you're coming in really fast, and all that aerodynamic heating, well, if you don't do things properly, it'll just burn you up and you die. But it's not enough atmosphere to really make your job easy, kind of like here on Earth where we have this thick, thick, soupy atmosphere that once you slow down, you pop a parachute and you come gliding down real nice and gentle. So it's kind of the worst of everything in terms of atmosphere. And so it's kind of unfortunate, but again, it makes our job fun because it's challenging. Topography. It's a very rough planet. Not a lot of erosion going on there because there aren't there's no water, liquid water there anymore. And so it's a very, very rugged place to land. And that's what makes it really hard for the landing system, the touchdown system that we're going to talk about tonight. Because you got to deal with rocks and slopes and all sorts of fun things. And so that gives you a little bit of background about Mars and some of the very high level what the challenges of actually landing in Mars are. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about what we call the six-minute challenge. Some of you guys probably know a little bit about this, but this is the entry, descent, and landing process. When you first arrive at Mars, your spacecraft is traveling very fast. In fact, we're going roughly 12,000 miles per hour. So that's very fast. And so when that spacecraft comes in and hits that atmosphere, it's kind of like taking a bowling ball and you drop it in a pool. Boom, suddenly you stop. And there's so much friction on that spacecraft that the front end of the spacecraft is actually, you know, thousands of degrees Celsius. So you got to deal with that. And in fact, it's this atmospheric heating which actually absorbs 99% of all that energy that you're coming to Mars with. It's actually taken up by drag and heating by friction. And so you got to get that right. And so far we have. But that'll only get you down to about 1,000 miles per hour. And again, that's because the atmosphere is so thin. At about 1,000 miles per hour, you kind of start losing the effect of atmospheric drag, of friction. And so that's when we pop our parachute. So you can imagine the spacecraft traveling at 1,000 miles an hour, and boom, you pop your parachute. Going about Mach 2 on Mars. And so you're dealing with shock waves and all sorts of really interesting and fun things. But the atmosphere is so thin that you can really only get down to about 200 miles per hour with a really good parachute. Trying to get down slower than that, you'd wind up with parachutes bigger than we've ever built. And so that kind of limits what you can do with a parachute. But you got to do that because that's a heck of a lot of velocity reduction that you're dealing with, but really only 1% of the total energy you came in with. So once you've popped your parachute and you've slowed down to about 200 miles an hour, you've got to do something else. We call that powered descent. And that's when you turn rockets on. That's when you use rocket thrust to slow you down even further. And so we take that from about 200 miles per hour down to about 4 miles per hour, 40 miles per hour, depending on the spacecraft. Here I've got a picture of the Mars Exploration Rover spacecraft where you still have the parachute attached. And here you can see the rockets coming down, the thrust coming down, and the airbags and things about ready to land. And all of that rocket power really only takes out 0.2% of all of your energy. So it's not a lot, but you got to do it. And so even there, if we were to land at 4 to 40 miles per hour, you know, you can break a lot of things going that fast. You can imagine driving your car into a wall at 40 miles per hour. It's not going to like it too much. And so that's why we have the last part of this, which is we call the touchdown event or the landing. This is sort of a quick evolution of different landing techniques that we've used in the past. And again, here you're taking out a tiny, tiny percent of the energy. But as I say, it's not the fall that kills you, it's the landing. And so we take that very seriously. And tonight, I'm going to get into how we actually got from legs all the way to landing directly on our wheels. Long, convoluted process, but it's a lot of fun. So what is the sky crane? Well, this is the Mars Science Laboratory entry, descent, and landing sequence. Walk you through this so you can see what the sky crane is, and then we'll talk about how we got into it. So here's the parachute coming out like we talked about. At about 1,000 miles per hour, we hold on for not even a minute. We pop open the heat shield, expose the rover, turn on our rockets. Actually, we wait till we let go before we turn on our rockets. And then we drop out of there. Now it's on rocket power all the way down to the surface until we get to about 100 feet off the ground. And that's when we do what we call the sky crane maneuver. You'll see here in a second. We've got a little reverse winch here which deploys these cables. Deploy the rover, stretch it out, and then fly the system. Boom, right to the ground. We cut the cables off, and then this thing that we call the descent stage, it just flies off and it crashes. and it's done its job. Yes, we litter Mars. We're very sorry, but sometimes you have to break a few eggs to make an omelet. And so now here we are on the surface of Mars, and that's the rover. Since the purpose of this talk is not to talk about the surface mission, we're going to keep going. So why do we have to do this new, different sky crane landing system? Well, as you can see here, we kind of outgrew our technology, if you will. We started off in the 90s with the Sojourner rover, and if you haven't seen it already, there's a full-scale mock-up of both of these rovers in the museum over here. So the Sojourner rover was 25 kilograms when we landed on Mars. So it was a small thing, about yay big. Spirit and Opportunity, they were 175 kilograms. You know, significantly bigger. But the science that we wanted to do on Mars for the Mars Science Laboratory was much more ambitious. We wanted to put an organic chemistry laboratory on Mars and actually see if we could find the traces of life that may or may not have existed on Mars. And that takes a lot of instruments, a lot of mass. And so you can see here the science instruments, the drills, all sorts of stuff. Needless to say, the rover needed to be big in order to do all of that, and wound up at 925 kilograms. And we knew that it was going to be big, and so we knew we had to do things differently. So when we got started on the Mars Science Laboratory project, we one of the things that we did was say, well, what are the different options that we have for actually landing on the surface? Let's go back, make sure that we've looked at everything that's been done in the past. We'll take from history everything that we can, and if it doesn't serve our needs, then we'll invent what we have to. And that's exactly what we did. And so what I'm going to do now is walk you through the historical things that we looked at, the legs, the first legs, and walk you through there. But actually, before I do that, there's two different paths that the evolutionary chain went through to get to where we are today. The first path is what we call the leg path. The different landers in the past that have used leg technology to do that final touchdown sequence. And then over here, there's the airbags. And we'll see here as we walk through the next, 40 minutes, 50 minutes here, the path that we went to go from legs and airbags down to what we call the Mars, or the sky crane landing system. So I'm going to start off with leg technology, and we'll talk about Surveyor and Apollo. This is a great picture. I love it because it shows the very, very first lander that landed on the surface of the moon successfully. It's called the Surveyor Lander, 1969. And I think it landed a little bit earlier. And then back here, you see the picture of the lunar excursion module that the astronauts used to land. This is a great picture because the astronauts knew where this was. They targeted that place. They landed nearby. They came over here, and they planned on it. And they actually broke off a piece of that spacecraft and brought it back. And I think it's in the Smithsonian somewhere. I'm not sure where. But it was really, this is a great picture because it shows two of the first landers, the first leg landers that were really wonderful things. The lunar excursion module is still the granddaddy of all the landers. The thing is the size of a house. The two guys lived in it for a week. It was really neat. But if I do say so myself, the Mars Science Laboratory and the spacecraft that we put together here, I think is probably the most ambitious and the neatest spacecraft that has ever been built, maybe second only to this guy there. So. But I'm biased, what can I say? So this is a drop test of the Surveyor lander. The first lander that we put on the surface of another planet, it was a rough ride. The radar technology was in its infancy. Guidance and control technology was still in its infancy. And so, they came down pretty fast and came up with a very innovative landing system. But it was a rough ride, and we needed to do better than that. Interestingly enough, at about the same time, the Soviets were developing what they called the Lunokhod mission, which means moonwalker. And this rover here actually was about 2,000 pounds, not too far different than the MSL rover that we're talking about. They were landing on the moon, though. So as I mentioned before, the moon is actually a much easier place to land, so they had an easier job back then. They didn't have to worry about fitting inside of a big capsule. They didn't have to worry about packaging a big parachute on top. But they built a fantastic, fantastic spacecraft. I believe they landed two of these successfully, and they operated them for months. They could actually joystick them on the surface. They took a very different track. They actually put the rover on top of the lander, and they deployed a couple of ramps, and they drove off. and whether they were willing to accept more risk or they didn't fully understand all the risk they were taking. It was definitely a riskier mission from an overall point of view in terms of ability to land on rocks, ability to land on slopes, and being able to get the rover off successfully. But they pulled it off, and it was a great mission. It was a great spacecraft. At about the same time, in the early 70s, NASA was designing its very first Mars lander. This is called the Viking mission. We designed and built two of them, flew them both successfully to Mars. Absolutely fantastic. And from a Mars point of view, this is really the granddaddy that we really respect around here, because they tackled all of those first problems, the parachutes, the heat shields, the landing systems, the landing on slopes and rocks, and reaching out and grabbing soil and doing things with it. They did a fantastic job, but it was a static thing. It landed on three legs and just stuck there. Didn't really have mobility. They were thinking about it, though. It was the very, I'm going to show you a picture here, which is the very first attempt at the evolutionary path to reach out and say, hey, what about mobility? And what about landing directly on wheels? They never built this, but they tried. They built a little prototype here, and what they did is they replaced the landing pads with these tracks, these like tank tracks here. So I found this image years and years ago, and I was just startled by it. I thought it was fantastic. I always remembered this. And so this is a good example of where evolution tries to go somewhere, but it just got cut off for one reason or another. In this case, it was funding. So then for 20 years, pretty much nothing happened. After Viking landed successfully, there was really a hiatus in terms of planetary missions to land on other planets, until the Mars Pathfinder mission came along. And JPL was assigned this, and they said, hey guys, go figure out ways of putting small, inexpensive landers on the surface of Mars. We can do these networks and land, you know, maybe even dozens of these things. And so we went back and said, it was me and a bunch of big team of folks, and we sat around and said, you know, what technology do we have? Well, we have the Viking technology landing on legs and rockets, but that seems pretty expensive to us, and especially if you want to do dozens of these things. You know, what's the cheaper way of doing it? So airbag technology had been around there. In fact, the Soviets had done it on the moon in the early 60s. And lo and behold, JPL actually did it. When we first started working on this, I'd been working on it for a couple months. And we were just, you know, looking around, doing literature searches. I came into my office, and somebody dropped this paper on my chair. And I'm looking, I'm like, wow, this is fantastic. Look what these guys did. And I looked at the author, and it was the guy sitting down the hall from me, a guy named Bill Lehman. Some of you guys probably know him. And I looked at the date, I'm like, wow, that was before I was born. But it was really good stuff. And so we adapted that technology. We adapted what they had done back in the 60s using Mylar and piano wire, which is why it never went anywhere. We had Kevlar and nylon and all sorts of really good stuff. And so we invented the Mars Pathfinder airbag system. And it was a much bigger system than you see here. And lo and behold, it worked. But obviously, in order to land this thing, as you saw in the six-minute challenge there, you got to get this thing down to 20, 30 miles per hour, 40, 50 miles per hour if you really had to. That's what we wanted to get the system down to. We were willing to land a little bit faster with this in order to save money on the rocket technology and to save money on the radar technology. And instead we said, why don't we invest in robust landing systems so we can save money on the delivery system? And that was the philosophy of the Mars Pathfinder mission. And so what was the landing technology that we came up with? Well, some of you probably have seen this. This is the Mars Pathfinder and the MER landing system. So we have the touchdown system down here and the delivery system here. We put our rockets up above so they can be cheap, simple, easy to control. Airbags down at the bottom, they inflate quickly, seconds before touchdown. Rockets turn on. They deliver us to a standstill up in the air and we drop us off. And yeah, we actually did bounce that high, and probably actually much higher than was shown in that image, and our fragile little spacecraft was going for a ride for 3-4 minutes, bouncing and rolling. I think it was maybe half a kilometer that it bounced and rolled. And it was great. And the Mars Pathfinder actually came to rest on its base pedal and opened up. But we didn't care because we had designed it so it can open up in any orientation. But it was kind of an interesting coincidence. And so now here we are on the surface of Mars. We had to get the Sojourner rover off, which is, you know, for tonight's discussion, it's all about getting the rover to the ground. Well, clearly, this is a rover's eye view. It had a camera right there, and it looked back after it got off, and it had to come down these ramps. And from a rover's point of view, that was a big ramp, because it's a little rover. And so we built two of them, one on one side of the airbags and one on the other side. And lo and behold, only one of them actually fully deployed down to the ground. The other one was kind of stuck up in the air because the airbags didn't fully retract. And so it gave us a real sense of appreciation of the risk associated with getting a rover off of a lander. We knew it wasn't going to be easy. And so the team spent a lot of time designing this system. But you know, nobody really had ever anticipated that we'd only get one of those ramps down. So it really gave us an appreciation for the challenges of just that last step of getting from a stopped system to getting all six wheels on the ground. So before actually Pathfinder actually had even landed, the Mars program had kind of started going in a different direction. The next series of landers had been contracted out to the same aerospace contractor that had designed and built the Viking lander. And they were asked to go do the next series of missions. And we hadn't successfully landed on Mars yet because we were still, actually, I think we were still flying. And so, needless to say, they didn't want to invest their corporate, you know, reputation on unproven technology when they had their own proven technology of landing on legs. And so they said, look, we're going to just take our Viking heritage system and we're going to adapt it to the mission needs that JPL is asking us to do, which is much smaller landers, much less ambitious than Viking was. And so that was the Mars Polar Lander. There's actually another one that I didn't show here, which is the Mars 2001 Surveyor Lander. And then this Mars Sample Return Lander. And so, you know, that was, you know, we were all kind of sad. We thought, well, that was it for the Pathfinder, for the airbags. It was a fun technology, but no more. But, and so we started working on the Mars Sample Return Mission here at JPL. Mars Sample Return Mission was interesting because it was a big lander, quite big. The rover was significantly bigger than the Sojourner rover. This was intended to be roughly the size of the Spirit and Opportunity rover. And we actually were going to carry a rocket to the surface of Mars. The rover was going to drive off this ramp, go pick up rocks, bring them back up the ramps, drop them off into the rocket, get out of the way and let the rocket come back and bring the samples back up to orbit. We were going to grab them out of orbit and bring it back to Earth. Very ambitious program, very exciting, but for the purposes of tonight's discussion, the part that's germane is the fact that there's this big rover sitting on top of this big lander, and it had to get off. This approach here that you see there, very conventional, is what the Lunokhod guys did. It's very similar to sort of an extension of the way the Sojourner rover got off. So it was a very intuitive, very comfortable evolution into this, which is why we all kind of went into it. We weren't totally comfortable with it, though. There were range limitations. Clearly, once you get the rover off, you can't go very far because you've got to come back and you've got to drop off your samples. It's not like you can just go off and wander and see a great rock way in the distance. You have to make sure you can always get back. And then it has the issues that, well, once you drive back, driving back up this thing was going to be a challenge, too. That was probably one of the riskiest things that we had to do, and we didn't have a really good answer for it. And the robotics guys weren't really confident that they could have a robot arm reach down and grab a sample and do the handoff and put it back on top inside the rocket. And so it was a very complicated system, and it had a lot of risk to it, and we were never really comfortable with it, but that's where we were, and we're moving along. Then, lo and behold, kind of a sad day around here. Mars Polar Lander didn't phone home. You know, we didn't know what happened. It was a very dark time around here. I lost two spacecraft on that mission. Not the Mars Polar Lander, but we had the two Mars microprobes, which are these two little penetrator probes, which were sort of piggyback rides on there. I'd spent 3 years working on them. They also didn't make it. So it's pretty dark times around here. But we use that period of uncertainty and that period of introspection to figure out, all right, clearly something went wrong. What are we going to do? How are we going to learn from these experiences? Even though we didn't know what had happened yet, we were already shifting in our minds, how are we going to learn from this so we don't make these same mistakes, whatever the mistakes were. We don't take the same types of risks. So there's a lot of turmoil in the Mars program at the same time. And the Mars Sample Return took the opportunity to say, look, we've got some big issues here that we're not comfortable with. Let's take this opportunity to fix those issues. And one of those issues was the fact that we had to get this rover back up these ramps.
drop the samples off and get back off again. And we all sat around the table and said, hey, what if we, instead of making a little rover and a rocket over here and the big lander that's kind of done its job after it's landed and it's just sitting there, what if we make a bigger rover, one that's big enough to actually carry the rocket on its back? That way, it just drives off this thing, carries its rocket, and just goes hiking wherever it wants to go, wherever the scientists tell it to go. When it finds the samples that it likes, it puts them in its back and keeps going. And eventually, if it runs out of steam and breaks a wheel or gets stuck somewhere, that's okay, because it'll just lift its rocket and shoot off the samples. And so we thought, hey, that's a pretty cool idea. We like that. But unfortunately, Mars sample return mission got canceled, and we were kind of bummed. And that was a consequence of the Mars Polar Lander failure and the Mars program trying to figure out what it was going to do and how to readjust its thinking. And so it was unfortunate, but it wasn't too bad because Mars sample return mission morphed into a new project, which we called the Mars Smart Lander. This was a less ambitious than the Mars sample return, but sort of the same objectives of trying to find out if there was ever any traces of life on Mars, doing organic chemistry on Mars. And that required bringing significantly more ambitious science instruments. And so, you know, when we did the math on how big this rover had to be, lo and behold, it was actually kind of the same size rover as we had just got done contemplating that could carry this rocket on its back. And so these ideas that we had on how to do this big rover with a rocket on its back kind of extended into the Mars Smart Lander project. Right around this time period, we started finding a little bit more about potentially what had happened to the Mars Polar Lander. There was concern that maybe it had tipped over because the slopes were a little bit more severe than we thought they would have been. And so, you know, we were given the task to figure out, get this Mars Smart Lander rover on the surface, but it needs to be able to handle more severe slopes, bigger rocks, and guys, do something to fix this egress thing, this big rover on top of this lander. If you land on the slope and you can't get off from this side here, then you got to go down this ramp here, and now you're looking straight down, and the rover is going to flip over. So we started being more conservative in our assumptions as to what Mars was, less willing to take risks in terms of getting the rover off. And so we had to come up with other ideas. So one of the things we came up with was, well, hey, these airbags work great. Maybe they will work for the large rover as well. Then we came up with this other idea called a pallet. And I'll talk about that in a second. But we really liked both of these ideas better than we liked the legged system. So we had to put some real meat into both of these ideas to demonstrate that one or both of those ideas was better than the legged lander. And out of these two ideas, which one was going to be the best one there? And so the pallet versus airbag duel began. And that's actually what it was. It was pallet versus airbag. And we spent, I don't know, maybe a good 6-9 months working that through. And so I'm going to take the pallet first, and we'll talk about the airbags. So we started off with this big three-legged lander with a rover sitting on top, the big Mars sample return rocket underneath it. That was the idea. That was the concept. That was the technology paradigm that we started off with. We wanted to improve stability. We wanted to be able to land on bigger slopes. We wanted to not waste so much mass either. Here we were wasting a lot of mass on these, you know, these legs which absorbed the energy and then all the structure inside of here which wasn't doing much for you. We wanted to figure out some way to make better use of all the weight, the mass that we were bringing to the surface of Mars. And then we wanted to improve egress. We wanted it to get easier and easier to get this thing off so we didn't have to worry about flipping this thing over or coming off the ramp or doing something. And so the first thing we tackled was stability. Hey, let's add some extra legs on there, some outriggers, just make this thing more stable. Hey, that sounds like a good idea. Well, it was an okay idea. And we said, well, at this point, we said, well, and this is a period where we had kind of morphed from the Mars sample return to the Mars Smart Lander. We had this big rover. We had this idea of a tripod lander with these outriggers on there for added stability. And we said, hey, what about egress? Let's make this egress system even more robust. Hey, we were comfortable with building airbags, inflatable things, because we'd done, you know, Mars Pathfinder airbags. So we said, hey, why don't we build these inflatable ramps, kind of like the emergency escape system from an airplane. Here we have them shown here rolled up, but you can imagine those three sausages, you know, unfolding, inflating, rolling out, and building these nice big curtains of ramp coming out there. And you can imagine if your rover on top of there, you can say, hey, I want to go off there. You turn and you just drive right off. That was the idea. Well, we started doing a math on the stability of the system, and it really wasn't that good. We had this big rover up on top, this big lander with these legs holding us up above the ground so we could land above a big rock. If you do a belly flop on a rock, you don't want to kill yourself, so you have to stand yourself up high enough above the biggest rock you want to land on. So now you've got a very high CG with a big rover up on top, a lander, and these long legs which are holding you above the rock. And we started doing the math on the stability of landing on slopes. It just wasn't looking too good. And so that's when we had the idea, well, what if we just, wouldn't it be cool if we could take this rover and just a pallet, you know, those things that the forklifts are always picking up and dropping things off. What if we just take a pallet, this pizza pan, just put the rover on top of it, and what if that could just land just like that? We didn't need to, we could find a nice, clean, elegant way of packaging all those propulsion tanks and rockets and just do a belly flop. Maybe we put some arms out and have that be our stability. So when we land, we're a nice big flat system. Instead of standing up high and tipping over, we're nice and flat. That was the idea that we had. And so we started exploring that a little bit and started generating some kind of goofy looking concepts, but they were kind of, you know, catching on to us. And so this was like a big slug of crushable honeycomb and a big flat pizza pan there. And then we had these outriggers out there. There's no idea how we're going to get all those rockets and computers and stuff in there, but that's okay. It was just an idea, and we liked the idea, so we called it the pallet. So we said, well, let's spend some time on it. Let's see if it's got any merit to it. Let's evolve the concept a little bit. And sure enough, that's what we started doing. We started figuring out how to get the rocket motors in there. We started figuring out how to get the tanks in there, how to get the computer in there. We started stretching fabric out between all these outriggers here, so now the rover could, here's still shown squatted down in its launch and entry configuration, but the next step would be to stand the rover up, then it can look around, decide which way it wants to come off, and it would just drive right off. And so that was the idea, and we liked that. And then we took it even further, and we came up with this, you know, really sexy pallet, very aggressive. We put these nets underneath it to keep rocks from coming up between the legs, and it was really neat, and we really liked it. And so that was part one of the duel, the pallet. And we liked it. In fact, we liked it so much that we actually built a prototype of it. We said, well, let's see if this thing behaves the way we really think it's going to behave. This is a 3/8 scale pallet. The ratio of Earth's gravity and Mars gravity is 3/8. So if you build your models at that same scale, you get a lot of really cool benefits from an engineering point of view. You can get some really good data. In fact, we did this really neat drop test where we built this scaled rock and a scaled slope, and we dropped it. These are the types of terrains that we were trying to land on. Very aggressive, very ambitious. This was one of our very early tests, and it was stable. Not very fun, I mean, very risky, but it was stable. If you had taken a tripod lander on that terrain and tried to do that landing, it would have just flipped right over. So we knew we had something good. We were very excited about it. So hold that thought. Now let's switch over to talk about airbags. So I'm going to talk about the evolution of airbags for the Mars Smart Lander. And clearly, we had done the Mars Pathfinder airbags, and that was our starting point. We said, well, how do we maximize the heritage from that system? In that case, it meant keeping the same idea of these lobes, and the amount of pressure that you put inside of them, and roughly the energy that you have when you land. The energy is your velocity and the mass of the system when it lands. Well, clearly, we were going to be much bigger, much heavier than the Mars Pathfinder system, so the airbags had to grow. They grew a lot. So here we had 4 airbags. Each airbag actually has 6 lobes, so it looks like there's a lot of airbag, but there's actually 4 airbags. Here we had to have 6 airbags because this rover was kind of like this big box-shaped thing. And so we put 1 airbag on each side of the box, and we had this, you know, wild set of cables trying to hold onto the rover. And it was a very complicated system, but it was very, I mean, it was doable. One of the things that we realized right away was that since it is so much bigger and it is so much heavier, we're going to have to slow the delivery system down. In order to maintain the heritage of the pressure and the size of the lobes, we're going to have to slow the system down. So we started talking about the delivery system. Well, we started off with the Mars Pathfinder delivery system. We had a parachute and a rocket system here, a big long cable, and the airbags at the bottom. Good place to start. But in order to get more control out of the system here, we couldn't use these very inexpensive, cheap, what we call solid rockets. You turn them on and they just go, kind of like those Estes rockets, but much bigger and much more expensive. We had to use liquid fuel technology, where we have a tank, you have plumbing, you have a rocket, and you have a throttle valve, and you can actually control the thrust very carefully. And we needed better radars, of course, too. And so this system here morphed into the Mars Smart Lander delivery system, where we had a shorter tether because we didn't need it to be so long, the big airbags down here, and then this liquid rocket-powered descent stage. At the time, the radar technology and the guidance technology and our comfort level was such that, you know, we needed these big airbags because we just didn't think we could land it soft enough to not have airbags. And we wanted to go to very ambitious places. And so we came up with this really neat system where we were tucked up. The rover was tucked up inside of this descent stage. And then as we're getting close to the ground, we deploy the system, deploy the rover, boom, inflate the airbag seconds before touchdown, touch the system down, cut off the rope, and have this descent stage fly off and crash. So very sky crane-like, but we really just didn't have the confidence level in landing right on the wheels. So in fact, Sam Thurman was actually advocating, hey, guys, you know, if we just do a little bit more on this, we could actually land it right on the wheels. But it just, you know, it wasn't, we weren't there as an institution yet. We weren't there as from an engineering community standpoint. And so we didn't have the confidence to make that our baseline. So we said, this is what we have confidence. This is what we think we can do. So let's keep working on this concept. So one of the big challenges with a big airbag concept like this was, you know, the Mars Pathfinder, we had this structure inside of the airbags, which was this tetrahedron, had these big motors on the corners of the lander. And after the thing came to a stop, we would just actuate all of those motors and the thing would open up. And lo and behold, regardless of what orientation you were in, you would wind up rover up. And it worked great. We tested it hundreds and hundreds of times, and it was great. And we call that the rollover system. Well, we couldn't afford a big structure box with these giant motors and everything on a system like this because it would just take up all the weight that we had. And that would have been way too expensive and way too massive. So we had to come up with some other way of self-righting ourselves, because with airbags, you're just going to roll around and you're going to come to a stop on your back and you got this rover saying, help me, help me, am I going to get over? And so we had to come up with a way of getting it self-righted without using a lot of mass. And so, hey, we know airbags. We like airbags. Let's use airbags creatively. So we actually came up with this really neat system that we call the inflatable self-righting system. And so here you see a little mock-up of, this is about yay big, a 3/8 scale again of the rover. And there it is laying on its back. And the idea was that we would have this funny-shaped sausage inflatable system folded up and wrapped up around the rover in such a way that regardless of what orientation it's in when it comes to rest, as you inflate this thing slowly, not real fast, but slowly, it folds its arms out, it folds its legs out, and it forces the rover to be, you know, right side up. And if that wasn't hard enough, we realized that on Pathfinder, we had this big lander structure out there. We actually built these little winch motors that had these shoelace strings, very high-strength shoelace strings that wrapped around the inside of the airbags. And when we turned that motor on, it would draw in the airbags. It would tuck them up, nice tight ball into the side of each pedal. And then we would open it up. So that was called airbag retraction. And we had something to retract them against. Here we didn't have anything to retract against. So we said, hey, let's extend this idea to actually flip the airbags off. So here you see the same sequence without the airbags, and this is with a fake set of airbags. These are the big fabric fake airbags that we built to demonstrate the idea. And sure enough, it worked. And we're like, wow, this is pretty cool. But so then we had the dual. We had done enough work on this. I think that's the last picture I have on this. We had done enough work on both the pallet and the airbag. We put all of our information together, and we had the big shootout, the big dual. And, well, we just had not convinced ourselves well enough that we could make this airbag system work. And here you see some of the many, many, many permutations that we'd went through in terms of the descent stage. We started off with two arms and then a whole bunch of little rockets and then even more rockets. And it evolved up until the thing that we brought to the big the big down select conference. And the airbags, this wasn't the only airbag. We didn't come up with that one right away. We went through dozens of different ideas on different airbag shapes, you know, many lobes, a few lobes, toroidal systems. But in the end, the complexities and the risks and the challenges left in this one, they were just too big. The tripod lander, you know, when we just started doing our stability analysis and our egress analysis, it just wasn't cutting it. We killed that guy earlier on, and we focused on the pallet and the airbags. And so the pallet was actually very attractive. It was very stable. We had a lot of confidence in getting this rover off of the pallet. And it became the baseline. It won. It was it. And so the Mars Smart Lander project started moving happily along with that. Well, all of this work happened in just under the course of a year. And it was during this year that the Mars program was trying to figure out what it was going to do after it failed the Mars Polar Lander, canceled the Mars sample return mission, and there was this contest going on between, are we going to send a big orbiter, which wound up being the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter back there, or rovers, which wound up being the Mars Exploration Rovers. Well, right at this time, this is when the Mars Exploration Rover project got initiated. So all the folks who were working on this got pulled from this and went to go work on the MER. So here we are, starting over again. Now we've got a big rover, so we were comfortable. Hey, we had this big rover, and now we're going to grow the rover from Sojourner. Instead of being this big thing, we're going to grow this medium-sized thing. So how do we get this medium-sized thing packed in these airbags? Well, we did this origami thing where we folded the rover into this crazy shape inside the lander. And since it was actually wound up being a lot heavier, we actually had to get smart about how to reduce the velocity. So the guidance system in those rockets that we saw before, the guidance team actually did a lot of work on modifying that system, adding control, some extra side-facing rockets to be able to control out some of the horizontal velocities. They did some improvements on the radar, some improvements on the guidance technology, and they were able to bring the touchdown velocities to much, much better control. They did a lot of really good work there. And then when it came to getting the rover off, well, clearly you see here, we borrowed from some of the ideas that we had come up with on the pallet lander, where we said, gosh, you know, we're not too happy about just having the rover stand up and drive off one side or the other. We wanted to be able to go off of any side that it can. And so we came up with this thing we called the bat wings. We had these two arms, one arm here, and the same thing is on both of those sides there. And these arms folded out, and we stretched fabric between them, and the rover could decide any direction they wanted to go off. It could come off this side, this side, this side. It was called the Impact to Egress Team. Those guys spent months and months and months and months developing this, fine-tuning this. Joel Krajewski, Kevin Burke, Chris Voorhees, those guys, they did just an incredible amount of work trying to figure out how to get this rover to stand up and drive off of this lander, which is really only this high off the ground, safely. It was a very, very challenging, very risky thing. And in the end, this is what they came up with, and it worked great. So now, chronologically, MER, Mars Exploration Rover, Spirit and Opportunity Landers, we get done designing and building them. We launch them off to Mars. So now we got this team. We're all ready to go. We're all excited. We just got done doing this very, very exciting mission. Well, so we're ramping down off of that. This is when the Mars Smart Lander, I'm going to get my acronyms right, the Mars Smart Lander said, okay, it's time for us to start ramping back up. We want to start getting this mission, which has been on hold during the Mars Exploration Rover, we want to get it going again, so let's start bringing the people back from this mission here and start working on the next mission. So that's when Dara Sabahi was our chief engineer for the Mars Science Laboratory, Mars Smart Lander back then. It transitioned from Smart Lander to Science Laboratory, so the acronyms are the same, and at this point here we're still a Smart Lander. Actually, no, this is when we transitioned into the Mars Science Laboratory. So Dara Sabahi said, hey guys, we're about to really kick in what we call the standing army. You're going to get dozens and dozens, if not hundreds of people, moving on developing, you know, this pallet lander. Let's sit around and let's just have one more little get-together to make sure that we've got the right landing architecture. Yeah, we know and love this pallet lander because we invented it a couple years ago, and not too much has been happening to it in the last year or two while we've been doing the Spirit and Opportunity mission. We're going to really kick it in strong and really put a lot of effort into this. Let's just make sure it's the right thing to do. So literally, a bunch of us sat in the conference room and said, you know, let's just clean off the whiteboard and say, if we had to start from scratch, what would we do? What are the things that we really like and what are the things that we don't like? And we went back and said, you know, we really liked the fact that, you know, on this airbag system here, we never had to turn the engines off. The engines were on the whole time, and even when we landed, we had complete control of the system. And the controls guys, who had just got done adding those rockets and radars to the Spirit and Opportunity, said, hey guys, we feel pretty good about this. We know how to do this. We can do an even better job. We can get our velocities down real small. Let's take advantage of that. There's got to be some way to take advantage of that. And the propulsion hardware was up high. It never had to crash land that propulsion hardware. You never had to protect it from rocks. If you break, if you crack open a prop tank, it's kind of the end of the day. You know, you crack the stuff open, all this rocket fuel goes spilling all over the place. Not a good story. And so that was one of the challenges that we had with the pallet lander. It was a great idea, and we were going to protect it. We were going to use automotive technology and build in these crumple zones and be very lightweight. But we still had these rockets right next to the ground. And we weren't too crazy about that, but what we did really like about this system was that the rover was right down on the ground. It was really close to the ground. It was going to be really easy to get this guy off. So we thought, you know, is there some way to take advantage of the best of both worlds? This nice high propulsion system with a lot of control, this rover that's, you know, ready to drive off and hardly any kind of egress needed. And lo and behold, after a lot of throwing stuff on the whiteboard and yelling at each other. So, no, that's no good. What about this? What about this? That's how our meetings really go. Boom, this thing comes up. Hey, why don't we just use our descent stage, drop the rover down, deploy the mobility while it's in the air, and just put it down right on its wheels? And we looked at the controls guys and said, we can do it. You know, we said, we probably need a better radar, and we might need some better rocket motors, but we can do it. And so we were very excited about that. Very excited about that. And so the new duel began. We had the pallet. That was our baseline. That was the project was, you know, hey, it had fully signed up to it, and we had all signed up to it. But this much better idea had come up, and we said, we can't just ignore it. We got to try it out. We got to see what we can do with it. So we spent 5-6 months really fleshing out the idea. And I put these old view graphs in here because part of this talk, I'm going to show you the evolution of these ideas. And this was really what it looked like. This is our first PowerPoint sketches that we drew. We just take a little icon of a rover, a little icon of this descent stage, and then put a little PowerPoint line in there. And, hey, guys, what do you think about this? And so we spent months and months working on developing this guy, the sky crane idea. And we had another one of these big down-select meetings. And it was called the Pallet versus Sky Crane Down-Select Meeting. And we had all the graybeards, and we had all the team members, and all the non-advocates there, the people who, hey, they don't care which way it goes. They've got nothing vested in either one of the concepts, so they're neutral. And we said, you know, this is what we think are the pros and cons of this system. This is what we think the pros and cons of this system are. We're happy with this. This is what we want to recommend. What do you guys think? And so the duel ended, sure enough. The sky crane landing system won. It was really interesting. It was a great meeting. It was a great time because it was actually kind of scary because by any description, this is a very, very audacious system, very unconventional, very off the wall. And we all have a very, very real sense of responsibility around here, and we didn't want to put forth something that was so unconventional that we didn't think we could actually pull it off. And this was taking a major step from conventional technology. And so it was a very big deal to all of us, but we knew how we got there. We knew that the descent stage had evolved from the Mars Pathfinder system with rockets on top and a radar and a control system. And we'd evolved it over time, and we really liked that, and the team knew how to do that. And we knew rovers. We knew how to get rovers down. We knew how to build rovers and how to deploy them. And combining the best of all those things, it was just the right thing to do. And so it won, and that was what we chose. And so then came the evolution of the sky crane itself. Well, what's it going to look like? You know, how's it going to be? And there was a lot of choices and a lot of different things to develop on it. So the first thing you see here is, you know, we had a 950-kilogram rover back then when we started. So we needed 8 engines to make that happen. And you see here a big, long, single bridle. And that's what we did on Pathfinder, and it worked, and it seemed like an appropriate place to start. And so as we got more and more into it, you know, we realized that 950-kilogram rover is probably more than what we really wanted to bite off. So we had a really big mass savings exercise. So we dropped the rover down to 650 kilograms. And so we could take out some of the descent stage engines and simplify it a little bit more. And we realized that we needed an umbilical to send electrical signals down between the rover and the descent stage, because the computer's on here, but the rockets are up here. So the two things have to talk to each other the whole time. And so, again, back here, this is just a little PowerPoint line. We kind of stick it in there and say, hey, we need an umbilical. So this is the evolution. Not very sophisticated, but the ideas were starting to congeal and start to formulate. So then the rover grew from 650 to 750 kilograms. You know, as you get smarter, you realize that, you know, you need more things. You know, it really is an evolutionary process. And the rover, the delivery system was evolving, but the rover was evolving too, because up until now, the 175 kilogram rover, we knew how to do that. But when you grow to this large of a rover, things change. You got to do things differently. So you make some, you place some bets on your technologies, and some of those bets don't pan out. And that's the whole development process. So you want to get those lessons learned early. And so it started growing, and not too surprising. And so we also realized that, gosh, if I have my rover hanging down here off of one cable, this thing is just going to, like, you know, be bouncing all over the place, and it's going to sit there and oscillate, and it's not going to be a lot of fun. So we need 3 cables coming down here. All right, we can handle 3 cables. We'll do that. It seems like a good idea. And then, so the rover actually stayed put here. We just started adding fidelity to our system. We realized that we needed a radar. So now we had our propulsion module. We realized that the radar had to look over and down around the rover. So we built this big structure out in front of the descent stage. And we remembered that we needed electrical umbilicals, so we PowerPointed that in too. And so then the rover grew again. Now we're at 850 kilograms. So the 8 engines were back in. And so you see here, we had 6 engines here, and now we had 8 engines. And you see the 8 engines. I apologize for, you know, how tight these images are, but I, you know, time is of the essence here, so I couldn't have too many slides. So we clustered our engines in there, and they were nice and tight. And finally, we did some analysis, and the controls guy said, "No, if you keep your engines like, you know, 2 pods of engines like this, then I have no control in this direction. I got plenty of control in this direction, but I can't control the spacecraft in this engine. You're gonna have to spread your engines out that way." And so, you know, we did that. And so we spread them out. And it's an evolutionary process. And you know what? The rover grew again. It's funny because of the way I present it here, but it's, you know, the team is working really hard, and it's a very, very, very challenging rover. It's very ambitious. It's a nuclear-powered rover. It's got this incredible laboratory on top. It's got this spectrometer that stands up and can look around. It can say, hey, I want to know what that rock's made out of. It zaps a laser at the rock. It pulverizes the rock, and it stares at this cloud of vapor that comes up, and it can tell what the rock is made out of. Very ambitious. It's got this incredible drill on it that can drill into a rock, collect the powder from the rock, sieve it, and say, I'm going to hit the small grains here, the big grains here, the medium-sized grains there, and I'm going to put them in my chemistry laboratory, one size in this one size in that one. I'm going to process them and shine lasers and shine radiation and shine all sorts of crazy things out of, and have a microscope in there. Just some incredible science going on in there. And so it's really not, it's to be expected that a system like this would grow. And we anticipated that, and we took provisions in the entry system, and we accounted for the growth. And so it was a really, really incredible evolutionary process of the sky crane landing system here itself. And you know, we started off with very simple cartoons. We did a lot of analysis. The analysis panned out. We did more analysis as the system evolved, and the deeper and deeper we looked into the sky crane architecture, the better and better it became, which is unlike things that we've looked at in the past. The landing legs, the pallet, in both cases, the more and more we looked into those, the more limitations we found. getting the rovers off, stability with this high CG thing. With the sky crane, it was actually the other way around. The more and more we looked into it, the more and more the architectural premises of how the system was supposed to work actually panned out. So what are those architectural premises, you ask? Well, let me tell you. So, I mean, I won't go too much into detail here because this is, you know, from one of our technical reviews. But the idea is that if you put your rocket motors up high and you place your radar up high, you can keep your control system on the whole time. Well, what does that mean? That means that you can control your velocity at touchdown very, very precisely. With these, one of the reasons that, well, the reason that the Mars Polar Lander failed is because it had designed a system the same way the Apollo lander had designed a system, the same way the Mars, the Viking lander designed a system, is that they don't want those rockets to be on once you make contact with the ground, because then the control system gets confused, it's not sure how to handle it, and it can cause some real problems. And so they design contact sensors in the legs that says, hey, as soon as I touch the ground, I'm going to turn my rockets off. Well, what had happened in the Mars Polar Lander is that those sensors that contact, that sense the ground contact, when those legs deploy, they have these big springs that deploy these legs when it comes out of the aeroshell, it accidentally triggered the sensors to go off. And that would have been okay because the computer guys were supposed to have ignored that initial signal, but long story, insufficient budget to do sufficient amount of testing. They never found out that that line of code never got fixed. And so on Mars, the landing legs deployed, that contact sensor said, hey, I contacted the ground. The computer says, hey, wow, we contacted the ground. That means you got to turn my engines off. So the engines got turned off, and it was still up high in the air, and the thing just came down to the ground. There were some other military and NASA technologies going on at the same time for doing this single stage to orbit rockets called the DCX, where they actually built this rocket which took off, flew around, then actually came back down and landed. And we consulted with those guys and said, wow, you had these rockets going on when you landed. You know, how did that work out? And they said, well, the worst part of it was contacting the ground and not spoofing the computer into thinking that you know, it's supposed to be doing something else. And so turning the engines off, it was very, very risky. And you need to do it as soon as you make first contact with the ground. And if you're on a big slope and you come down and you turn your engines off right there, well, you're going to keep falling. So you're going to actually pick up speed as you come down and get the last landing legs on the ground. And now you've picked up rotational energy, and this thing starts flipping over. And so the ability to keep our engines on during this whole event was just key. That gave us higher stability and lower landing loads. Well, how do you use that? You use that to say, hey, my rover's mobility system actually becomes my landing gear. And lo and behold, that mobility system is designed by its very nature to be compliant to the ground, to be able to articulate, to be able to adapt to rocks and slopes and varying terrain. It's designed to have a high ground clearance. And a high ground clearance is now okay because you're holding on to this rope the whole time you're setting down, so you don't have the same penalty of having a high ground clearance as you did when you were a legged lander where the thing was going to go flipping over, because you're holding on to what we call the hand of God up above until you got all six wheels on the ground. That's the basic architecture. A lot of engineering goes into this. A lot of design details, just, you know, tremendous amount of work goes into this. It's just unbelievable. But it was just a real beautiful thing to see that the deeper and deeper we got into the development of this, the basic fundamental architectural premises of the sky crane landing system really held firm. And it was very satisfying. So now I've got some really fun images of, this was a prototype, we call this one the Scarecrow. Gorgeous thing. Here you see it being tested on a platform with some rocks on it. You see the three cables going up. We had this big mechanical winch up on top, which would lower the rover and set it down. We'd simulate the landing events. We'd have computers on board here to measure all the forces and loads inside the wheels. Here you see it over here. This is actually the flight rover. The rover team, just an incredible job. Chris Voorhees, Jamie Wado, just tons and tons of people working on this thing. Did a tremendous job, and it's a very aggressive, very mean-looking rover, and it's really beautiful. And then here you see the flight hardware. You see the descent stage, just like you saw in the CAD pictures and the little PowerPoint sketches. Here's the real thing. You see the eight rocket motors here with their little red plastic covers on them to protect them, the big radar up front, the propulsion, the fuel tanks here. You see the electrical umbilical coming down here, the three cables, and then here's the rover. When this picture was taken, only two of the wheels had been bolted on, so that's why you don't see all of the wheels, one and two. And then here's another picture of it from a different angle. Just gorgeous, gorgeous hardware. If you haven't come to open house to see it, you get a chance to come next year. We were supposed to be launching this fall, but as fate would have it, we're slipping. So the hardware will be here to watch and to look at for another couple of years. I strongly encourage you to come check it out. So this is another picture kind of up close. You see the cables all come into one point here. We call that the confluence point. That was one of the architectural premises of this whole thing. We worked really hard to keep that confluence point at the center of gravity of this descent stage so that, you know, as this rover is swinging and doing its things underneath here, it wouldn't cause the descent stage to rotate. It would just pivot about that point there because it was the center of gravity. And that way the descent stage could control itself any way that it really wanted to. And it took a lot of engineering effort to make that point be right where it is. But, you know, it was part of the architectural aspect of the system, and so we worked hard to make it be there. And so this is just sort of, you know, kind of a conclusion slide here showing, you know, touchdown systems evolved from the Surveyor to Apollo to Lunokhod to Viking to the Mars Polar Lander, the Mars 2001, which, by the way, I didn't mention Phoenix, but Phoenix was really this lander here. This is the Mars Polar Lander. This twin brother was being built, or sister was being built at the same time. It got canceled. Then it got resurrected into the Phoenix mission. Mars sample return. And so the touchdown systems here evolved to allow larger and larger rover sizes to increase landing stability and to improve egress. Airbag technology evolved over time to allow more mass to be landed. In order to make that happen, you need slower velocities to land. And so the delivery systems evolved over time to have bigger rockets and increased velocity control. And then all those things kind of merged and converged into the sky crane landing system. No touchdown system at all, landing directly on the wheels, great velocity control, just set yourself down right on your wheels, nothing extra needed to make it happen. And then my conclusion, which, you know, just kind of repeating what we said, we spent a lot of time looking at lots of different landing techniques. We tried to beg, borrow, and steal from history what we could. And in the end, we've got a beautiful system that, you know, we're going to launch in 2011 and knock on wood. It's going to work great, and we'll have another success. So that's the conclusion of my talk. We have a microphone here, and, you know, thank you. So we can we'll open the floor to questions and answers and use the microphone so that everybody can hear you, and I'll be happy to answer whatever questions I can.
Yes.
Please.
Concerning the powered descent component.
Mm-hmm. The descent stage.
Yeah, the descent stage. You have a central point, center of gravity, so that the horizontal, it stays horizontal, but I'm wondering about the translational. If this thing is swinging back and forth,
right,
it's going to cause your stage to move sideways.
That's right. That's
right. Have you looked into the stability where you don't get positive feedback, where it accentuates that sway?
Yep.
Because that would be a problem when you touch down. You'd be coming this way.
Absolutely. Yes. We looked at that exhaustively.
Good.
And by having that confluence point at the center of gravity, it means that we don't induce torques, mm-hmm. and the descent stage has a lot of control authority. So it can sense that disturbance
dynamically.
And it doesn't, since it's coming in at the center of gravity, it doesn't know whether that disturbance is a big gust of wind or whether it's the rover swinging down there. It just says, okay, I'm being pushed this way, so I'm going to turn my rockets this way and counter that and then restabilize out. It's a very, very stable system, very rock solid.
Yeah. Second question.
Sure.
The 8 engines on board. Mm-hmm. If one of those engines should fail, have you accounted for that?
We do not have the luxury when we go to Mars to design in engine out failure conditions. So we need everything that we bring.
You need
bring,
all the ounces you can get of force.
What's that?
You need all the propulsion ounces you can get.
We need them all. That's right.
Okay,
we can't
you.
Handle that. You're welcome.
My question is, if you were in charge of another mission of small to medium size, like mm-hmm. the MER size or smaller, mm-hmm. would you go with this new system or would you go back to airbags?
You know, that's a really good question. And we get asked that kind of question a lot. And it really depends on what the mission wants to do. And it depends on the constraints of the mission. And it also depends on the risk posture that the institution is willing to take. Because we know that we can do the airbag system, and we know that we can do that well. And it really depends. So I don't want to be vague about it, but the genuine, honest answer is it really depends on a lot of factors. And the way we look at it as we now have a toolbox of solutions. And depending on what the objectives of the next mission are, because it depends on where it wants to go on Mars. For example, if it wants to go to a really flat area, you know, on a smaller system, maybe you can do this, or maybe you can do airbags. If you want to go into really rocky and slopey terrain, you know, it may not be obvious. And it may need something totally different. And maybe, again, we combine a little bit of this and a little bit of that and come up with the right answer for that mission. So I make a very, I actually have a policy that I try not to apply the same solution to an answer that I don't know what it should be until I've seen, until we know all the parameters of the problem. So.
And is this one considered more or less risky than the airbags?
We believe this to be much lower risk than the airbag system. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm wondering, because NASA is planning missions to go to the moon, how does this Mars landing technology apply to future landers on the moon? If you've thought of it.
You know, we haven't been asked to consider applying any of these technologies to a lunar mission. And conceptually, it's completely applicable to the lunar problem. There's nothing that wouldn't be applicable to it. It goes back to the previous question, is it the right answer to a lunar landing mission? And again, that goes back to what are you trying to do and where are you trying to go? And it might be that a simple three-legged tripod lander actually is good enough. I mean, if you're landing in a parking lot and you have very good control of where you're going to land, you know, actually a tripod may actually be a really good answer. So just because we deselected it for our constraints doesn't mean that it's a dead technology. It just means that it wasn't the right technology for our mission.
But if it's like the polar regions of the moon, then...
Again, even in the polar region, there's areas that are flat and more accessible. And what's nice about the moon is that you can target a much, much, much tighter spot because you don't have the atmosphere. You don't have to worry about winds blowing you around in the parachute. So if you say, I want to land there, you can pretty much land there. And that actually helps say, okay, well, I'm going to land in a spot, you know, a big old parking lot where there's no rocks, and I can actually back off on how capable my landing technology has to be. Thank you.
I don't have a question, but I have a comment. When I look at these machines, they look very Earth-like. They look very human. Some of them look like insects, but it looks like people to me. It's a comment.
Yeah, well, you know, there's an anthropomorphic genesis to a lot of the stuff we think about.
I just see humans in all these machines.
Yeah, I mean, you see me just gestating like this with my arms and legs, but, you know, when you do that, you say, hey, I need some kind of outrigger, some arms out there to keep myself from coming
your
out.
Your excitement and your agitation is really a wonderful thing to see. As
well. Thank you.
Thank you.
We need every advantage we can get.
I kind of have a little bit three.
Okay, go for it.
Okay, the first one is, if you have all the cables from the space, from the
descent stage?
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. If you have all the cables, if they're all coming from the same place and they're all spreading out, this has happened to me on, like, some occasions of, like, when I would need to do this, but when I have it like that, wouldn't it, like, spin around, and sometimes and the cables would get all twisted up and they could break.
Very good. You're a future engineer around here. That's a good question. When it comes out, since it's all coming to one point, what's to keep it from twisting around? That's a great question. And we ask ourselves that same question. It actually turns out that there's nothing to prevent it from spinning around. It can spin around, and it's actually very easy for it to spin up. The problem is you need something to start it spinning. And as long as you don't start it spinning, it won't spin. And so what we do is we wait to the very end to let the rover down, and the whole system is very stable. We're not turning. We're not spinning this direction here at all, or very, very little. And so when we let go of the rover, it's actually very stable. It'll come down and it's hold its position, and maybe a little bit of drifting, and maybe a little bit of rotation. And so that's mostly the answer. But what we also did is we did a lot of analysis. We did a lot of checking to see that if it did rotate, would that be a problem? And one of the things we had to check into was, you know, as we're coming down, we get these big rocket plumes coming down, right, literally inches from the rover. So we need to be sure that as the thing was coming down, if it started to rotate, it wouldn't get its wheels burned off from the rockets.
And I've got an idea for that.
Okay.
Just spread out the cables.
Spread out the cables. You could do that, but if you spread out the cables, then if the rover starts moving around, especially when it starts landing on the ground, it'll cause the descent stage to start to move around. And so we didn't want to do that. And so we were willing to take a little bit of risk on the rover turning, spinning in this direction here, just to keep those two things more isolated from each other.
Hold on.
Was that it?
That was one of them. That was sort of.
Okay.
And two more are very small. But since you have found evidence that Mars can have life or could have had life, since the ice...
We know that there was water on Mars, lots of water on Mars. That's what we know.
Yeah, so if you found, like, ice or something, if there was, like, itsy-bitsy molecules of, let's just say, Martians...
Uh-huh.
If the thing that comes down, the module...
Rover?
No, the...
Oh, the descent stage.
The descent stage. Yeah. If it... Like, let's say it just falls on one of their kings or something. Can't they get mad and, like, come and attack or something?
Well, you
know... Even though they're small, they could have a defense system.
That's a risk we're willing to take.
And also...
Last question?
My last question. How is that rover that comes down, how is it sexy?
How does it what?
How is it sexy?
How is it sexy?
I mean, it's a rover.
All right, yeah, you have to be an engineer to understand that one, so.
all I have is just two.
Okay.
First off, Is the sky crane supposed to be on every rover rover that's coming next? Or
no.
Is it just be like in between there? Is this like a like pattern type of thing?
Right now it's just like that it's the next mission we're doing. We're studying future missions, and as we study those future missions, we're gonna see if this is the right way of landing. In fact, we think it is, and so we're actually looking to adapt the sky crane for the next mission, which would be like in 2018 or something like that. So For this size of a landing system, there's a lot of advantages to try to reuse this technology. You get some cost savings, and you get to use the same things again. So it's hopefully we'll get to use it again.
Cool. And next time, it's kind of off topic, but how far are we away from zero gravity on Earth?
How far? We're one Earth gravity away from zero gravity.
Thanks for
or
owning me.
We're about 150 miles from that. If you go up into space and you're floating around
in
orbit.
It's just like simple, like zero gravity, like skateboard type thing, like from the Sonic Riders series or whatever. Just like floating. Just like floating discs or something, just like nothing. Oh, great.
No, sorry.
Okay,
maybe you'll be the person to invent it though, so.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Hello. I have a three-part question also.
Okay.
How many radio isotopic thermal electric generators will be on the
Very good.
Oh, thank you. On the MSL.
How many? Mm-hmm. We have one RTG. That's what we call it. One nuclear power source. And that nuclear power source has several little pea-sized pellets of plutonium in there. So you take a little tiny piece of plutonium, and then what they do is they encase it in these solid packs of graphite. And so, you know, if the rocket were to explode on its way up, these things are designed to re-enter and never release a single ounce of plutonium. And in fact, back in the 60s, when they first started launching these things for the military, I think, they actually crashed one of the rockets and it blew up on its way down. And this thing landed in the ocean. They got some submarines. They pulled it out perfectly good. The story goes that they reused it again. They're actually very, very, very safe. And they're great things. The Voyager spacecraft right there, that cylinder on the back, that's what that is. And it's because of that cylinder back there that we're actually still able to listen to the Voyager spacecraft, even though it's left our solar system.
Really?
Yeah.
Very interesting. Okay, and also I was wondering how many lasers and rock abrasion tools were on the MSL?
That's a good question. There might be somebody, Kyle back there, might be able to answer that question better than I can. Well, there's one drill. There's one laser thing that shoots down and zaps rocks from a distance. And spectrometers, I got to say there's at least three, maybe four, but I'm not totally sure. So,
okay.
Close enough, okay. Thank you.
Additionally, in regard to a landing site, have you considered where to land regarding the regolith? Because there's so much regolith on Mars.
Yeah, I wish I knew that. There's probably somebody in the audience here who can answer the question as to where our landing site is supposed to be. I don't know. But I know that the landing site selection process has been this big, long process involving a lot of scientists from around the country and around the world. And it actually involved a lot of discussion with the engineering team to understand what's the capability of the landing system. So they can say, okay, so these sites are too dangerous to go into, and these are okay, these have too high of a slopes, these have too much winds. And so they narrowed it down to the scientifically interesting sites and the ones that the spacecraft could actually land in.
I heard there was consideration of a landing site for Valles Marineris.
I don't know about that. I don't think there is.
That could be premature.
Yeah, I believe that we thought that the winds, when you go into the big canyon there, I think the uncertainty in the winds was pretty high, and therefore the size of the landing ellipse was going to grow. And so I wish I could give you a better answer on that one, but I can't. Sorry.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I know this guy. Yes?
When you were doing the landing thing for the flat one.
Uh-huh. The pallet?
When it hit the rock,
yeah.
What if there was a smaller rock? Would it flip over?
The kids are finding all the flaws in our designs. That's not fair. We need to invite you guys to more of our meetings. Yeah, in fact, it would. And the test that you saw there was the one that I could find the video of. But clearly for that landing system, the next thing, what we were analyzing was, you know, if you land like that and you what we call stubbing your toe on the next rock down, we had to make sure that we were stable for those landing conditions. And yeah, that's exactly what we tried to design it to do, and it actually did pretty well. That test there, we didn't have it in that test there, but
I have two more questions.
Two more, okay.
What would happen if you landed one of the tall ones on that?
The three-legged landers?
Yeah.
It would have flipped over, definitely. It would have gone over, it would have hit his toe, and it would have completely flipped over, probably even before it hit the ground.
One thing, if the rover did come out on, well, how does the rover get on its wheels when the triangle one came?
Oh, the airbag system?
Yeah.
So did you? There was a picture of the big like fabric tarp in front of it. So the rover just stood up on top of the solid part of the lander. It stood up, it stretched its wheels out, and then it just drove down off of the lander and over the fabric. So it actually drove on top of the fabric.
Oh.
Yeah. Thank you.
What type of materials were tested for the cables, and what is JPL's taking? What steps are JPL taking to prevent contamination of Earth's robotics on Mars?
Oh, good questions. The cables actually relatively low tech, since we had to control the length and the stiffness of the cable to what the guidance folks wanted. They wanted it to be not too stiff, not too soft. We actually used two different materials. One was Vectran, which is the same thing we built the airbags out of. And it's, you know, they build, make sailboats out of it. It's, you can pick up a catalog and just order tons of it. It's pretty conventional stuff. I mean, it's very expensive, and it's kind of like, you know, high-tech kind of stuff. But it's nothing too fancy. We didn't want to invent new materials. And then the other one was nylon, which is, you know, I'm probably wearing nylon right now. You're probably wearing nylon right now. It's because nylon is very stretchy, it's very soft, and the Vectran is very stiff. And in order to get a cable of the length that we needed to have the right overall stiffness, there weren't any materials that we could make solid out of one material. So we said, okay, let's make half out of this and half out of this, and that gives us the stiffness that we want. So that's what we did. And then the second part of your question is, the pictures of the flight hardware that I showed you there, you notice that everybody's dressed up in white bunny suits and gloves and the whole thing. Well, all we take very seriously what we call forward contamination of Mars. And we have rules and regulations on how much we're allowed to contaminate. And so everybody dresses up, you know, in the bunny suits, and we work, do things in the clean room where the air is filtered out every 5 minutes in super clean air. And then all the hardware gets cleaned with alcohol, and then things get baked out. And literally, we take big chunks of the spacecraft and stick them into an oven and bake them for like 3 days. And that kills all the bacteria and all the viruses and all the spores. And then we take it out and keep it all bagged until we get it back into the clean room. Then we carefully unwrap it, and then it only gets touched by people with gloves and wearing the whole suit. And so it's a very laborious process. And it actually, you know, it makes it difficult to work in those rooms, and we have to test our materials and our hardware and our mechanisms to be able to survive that.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
If this design works for the future Mars mission, will it be considered for future missions on other planets?
It'll be considered, absolutely. Whether it's the right answer for other missions, it depends on where you're going, what you're trying to do, where are you trying to go on the surface, and all those types of things. But like I mentioned before, we consider this to be another tool in our toolbox of possibilities, of options that we can use to put together. Think of it as like a Lego piece, right? All of a sudden, we got the sky crane, it's another Lego piece. So the next time we want to do a mission, you know, what do we have? Well, we have one more Lego piece, now we just got to figure out which technologies to combine to make the right answer.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
How much smarts are you using sort of in the last selection of where you're sitting down? You know, are you doing the, no, that's a 100-foot cliff, move over 100 yards?
We're doing no smarts at all. We call that hazard detection and avoidance. And it's actually a pretty challenging thing to do. It takes a lot of computer processing power. It takes some really good sensors, either, you know, good cameras or good radars or good lasers. There's a whole group of people here at JPL working on that. And they've been very successful at demonstrating that. But to mature the technology for flight is a very big deal. And, you know, when that decision point had to happen on MSL, and we considered it, when that decision point had to happen, we just said it's going to cost way too much, and the technology is way too uncertain, so we can't count on it. So that means we have to make ourselves robust to landing on all sorts of terrain. And once you've made that investment, then you don't need to make the investment on all the hazard detection and avoidance. So the payoff for the hazard detection and avoidance is you do that, and now you don't have to worry so much about the safety and the stability of your landing system so you can possibly go back to a tripod-type lander if that's a good answer for you, if you don't need a big rover driving off, you know, because you can just avoid the rocks and just land where you want.
Do you have a downward-looking camera on the descent stage to watch the landing?
No, but there is a downward-looking camera on the rover. It's, who's it? It's Malin and Jonathan Cameron. I think those guys teamed together, and they designed this really cool camera. And it's on the rover, and it's going to be looking down, and it's actually going to take a movie on its way down. And that's a big deal, because up until now, we've never actually taken movies during our landings, because it takes a lot of memory, a lot of computational power to do that and to store that information and to send all that stuff back. And this mission had more capability computationally and so on, and so they actually are putting that together. It's going to be really neat.
Okay, I was wondering, when you were talking about that six-minute mission thing, when you were saying about how the drag took about like 99% or something mm-hmm. like that, do you want the drag for the spacecraft coming
yeah,
down?
I mean, you want to get from Earth to Mars, you have to go fast. You have to go really fast. That means when you get to Mars, you're going 12,000 plus miles per hour. Somehow you got to get from 12,000 miles per hour down to zero. And so you
but
want.
Isn't that why you have the parachute?
Yeah, but the parachute wouldn't work going that fast. It would just disintegrate. So you want to use what Mother Nature gives you. So Mother Nature there gives us an atmosphere. And so it's a great opportunity to use the atmosphere to slow us down as much as possible. That way we don't have to carry so much with us.
And also, when you wanted the drag, did you, when you were building the spacecraft, did you build things that would cause drag, or did you just let the drag happen?
Great question.
On its own?
The shape of the heat shield, you know, we got that entry capsule. Well, the shape of that is designed to produce a lot of drag and to be stable so it doesn't flip over.
To me, it looks more aerodynamic than.
Well, it has to be aerodynamic, but it's this blunt thing. It's kind of like a plate, you know, going backwards. You know, so it's you know, you're pushing against the air, and it's creating a lot of drag. If it was long and skinny and sharp like a missile, then it wouldn't have a lot of drag, and it would go really fast, and it wouldn't slow you down as much. So, yeah, we designed the shape of the capsule specifically to produce a lot of drag.
Okay, thank you very much.
Got another question?
For the Curiosity, that arm that sticks out, what is that for?
On the what?
On Curiosity.
Yeah.
What's that arm that sticks down to the ground?
The arm? That's the robot arm that has, Kyle, what does that have? It has the drill. It has a spectrometer on it. It has a whole bunch of science instruments on it, because what the people who operate the rover want to do is they want to be able to drive up to a rock and say, hey, let's check out to see what that rock's made out of. So instead of taking the whole rover up to it, they can, with this robot arm, they can sample the top of the rock, the side of the rock, the left side of the rock. So they don't have to be super precise in how they approach the rock. They can use that arm to position all the various science instruments and drills exactly on the rock where they want them to be.
And also the two other rovers that are at Mars, mm-hmm. where are their drills?
They didn't have drills. They had what they call the rock abrasion tool, which was kind of like a drill, but is mostly scraping the surface of the rock, and it would make this round patch about that big where it put this abrasion tool up against the rock and would flatten it out and take away the outside of the rock so that the scientists could look at a very, very clean, very undisturbed part of the rock. And then they would put the microscopes and their spectrometers up against that spot.
And
thank you. You can ask me at home tonight if you have more questions.
Hi, two quick ones. How do you detach those cables?
How do we detach the cables? Yeah. So on top of the rover, where the three cables attach, we have pyrotechnic cable cutters. So it's just a cylinder about this big with a pyrotechnic charge on it and a blade, and boom, we just cut it.
So that's my second question. Initially, you had one cable and one umbilical. Then you opt out for three cables. So don't you think that it introduces more error, more chance for one of them not to work, and then the whole thing will drag the, the so what made you choose three instead of one?
Because if we only had one cable, then if the center of gravity of the rover was not directly underneath that, if it was off a little bit, then it would hang like that. And then what's even worse than that, because, you know, okay, maybe you can control that. And even if you did control that perfectly, which you can't, then what would happen is as the rover's released and it comes down, boom, comes to the end of its travel, it's going to start oscillating.
Wobbling,
it's going to start wobbling. And then there's absolutely nothing to keep it from wobbling. And the speeds that the extremities of the rover see as it's wobbling are actually pretty significant.
And, and that's when it might start rotating.
Yep.
Gotcha. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. How similar are the heat shield that you guys are using now compared to when they had on the Apollo missions?
So the Apollo mission used a round heat shield, and they used a material called Avcoat, which was it's hard to describe what it was.
It's like a layer of stuff.
It's a layer of honeycomb with this material packed inside of each one of the cells. But most importantly, it was the material, this Avcoat material, totally different, and the shape of the heat shield, totally different. Mm-hmm. We have more of a cone-shaped heat shield, kind of like the one that you see there, but a little bit different. So it's more of a cone-shaped heat shield, and we're using a material called pica, which is a fibrous, it starts off as a tile that they use like in furnaces, and it's like a, it's a very porous, fibrous tile, and then they impregnate it with like a phenolic, which is this gooey kind of carbon material that rigidizes it hard, and they put it into an oven, they bake it, so it's like this brick. It kind of feels and looks like wood, but it's not.
It's cool.
And we make those into tiles, and we machine them, and then we literally we bond them to the heat shield. So it's very different material.
And are there any projects you're working on getting people to Mars, or is that still sort of on the fringe of projects right now?
Got to have money for that.
I was just thinking about that. You know, it's a bit pricey.
I think that's going to be a while.
Yeah, it will.
It's going to be a while.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, great lecture.
Thank you.
I was wondering how long those rovers are supposed to last once they're on Mars? Or is that indefinite?
No. So the Spirit and Opportunity, they were supposed to last 90 days, I think something like that, 6 months, and they've been going on for 5 years, 6 years. I've lost track. MSL is supposed to, I believe, we're signed up to like 1 year. Maybe somebody knows the answer to that question. I think it's supposed to be 1 year. One Martian year, thank you. Yeah, and well, if it is one Martian year, that's two Earth years. And so that's a long time. And that's one of the reasons why we wanted the nuclear power plant. Also to be able to go into colder regions and to be able to keep the rover warm so we could operate it more often. So that's the idea.
And are you taking organisms there to study that, or is that...
Are we taking organisms there to do what?
To study organisms on other planets, or...
No.
Or is that...
I mean, we're taking organisms there, but not because we want to, because we can never clean it so well that we get them all off. So invariably, we're going to bring some bacteria, some microscopic organisms. But, you know, the fewer the better, and, you know, we really won't know what, you know, what's happening to them once they get there. So.
Okay, thanks.
I congratulate you on designing and building a very elegant landing system.
A lot of people involved.
It just seems to me, looking at the aeroshell and the three separate systems for getting the mission done on Mars, and part of that has to do with there are a lot of challenges with finding the right terrain, it seems, or making this thing rugged enough and versatile enough so that you can land almost anywhere within that certain radius that you have plotted. Has there been any discussion about, say, instead of an aeroshell, maybe something you could fly around, a lifting body, or something where you could sort of have this machine map and see where it was and then select a site and then go to a descent stage, or maybe something with chutes or a lighter-than-air vehicle?
Not really.
No. I know it's a lot of complexity, but
yeah, it's actually a huge amount of complexity, and we have such good orbital imagery, and we can see things down to, you know, a person or a chair almost. And so the scientists can really see Mars well. And so at least from now on, you know, they can say, I want to go here. You know, how small of a footprint can you give me? And so the engineering team says, this is how big our footprint can be. And so they say, okay, let's put this footprint over here. And that footprint is, you know, 10 kilometers. So that's pretty small. I mean, that's really small. And so the need to fly through the atmosphere to choose sites kind of goes away. What we actually do with our spacecraft is we actually do fly it while we're in the atmosphere, but very little. We have our center of gravity is not on the center of the spacecraft. It's kind of kicked over to the side. Mm-hmm. So instead of flying straight like this, we kind of fly crooked, and that gives us a little bit of lift. And then we use that lift as we're going through the atmosphere. The computer says, okay, I have this pre-programmed path that I'm supposed to be going like this, and if I sense that I'm drifting to one side, I'm going to turn my lift vector to get me back over here. And then that allows us to really shrink our footprint down to that 10-kilometer size. If we didn't do that little bit of flying through the atmosphere, mm-hmm. our footprint would be 100 kilometers, like it was on Mars Pathfinder and on MER. But on MSL, in order to narrow that footprint, to do what you said before we launch, to say, hey, let's choose where we want to go and fly there, we're doing that before we launch by choosing the location mm-hmm. with satellites and then doing a little bit of flying through the atmosphere to make sure that we land as close to that spot as we can.
And wind gust would not affect that as far as you
calculate? Yeah, it does. And in fact, we have to build our CG off. We have to have enough lift to counter wind. We have to have enough lift to counter changes in the atmosphere, hot days, cold days, if there's a dust storm. If there's a pressure wave, there's a whole bunch of different things that the atmosphere can throw at you. And you want to be able to have enough control authority to say, okay, whatever's happening, I can counter that and stay on my path.
And the computer is doing this.
The computer's doing it all by itself.
Yeah, very impressive.
Yeah, it is.
Thanks.
Okay. Let's make this be the last question, and then we got to cut.
You put the rover down, it's going to stay there 2 Earth years, and how far is it designed to go? Will it go, how far out will it go? 100 miles, 500 miles, 1,000?
Tens and tens of kilometers. I don't know. It depends on how many places the scientists want to stop and investigate and how long they want to stay there.
Okay.
Thank you. Folks, we have to end it. Thank you.